Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, Vaheguru Ji Ki Fateh. Today we're going to be looking at the Singh Sabha Lehar, or Singh Sabha movement. This movement in the last 20 years has become much more controversial. Many people are criticizing the effects of the Singh Sabha movement, and also some of the people who are part of the Singh Sabha movement. But what I want to look at today is what the status of the Khalsa Panth was before the Singh Sabha movement started, who the main sevadars of the Singh Sabha movement were, and what impact they had. Because whether you are pro or anti Singh Sabha, the thing is that we need to learn from our history. Over the last 300 years as a Panth, we have repeatedly made some mistakes again and again. And we continue to do that today. Whereas we need to learn from the past, we have fallen into a pattern of thinking that as long as our hearts are pure or our purpose is pure, we will be fine as a community. But the reality is that there are many powers, internal and external, that are always seeking to undermine the Khalsa Panth. And we need to be a little bit more intelligent and forward-thinking to try to understand who these groups are and how are they manipulating us and how we can try and find Guru Sahib's message and apply it to our life and our society. So we're going to start off with looking at what the halat, what the situation was in Punjab before the Singh Sabha movement. In the 1830s, the Khalsa Panth, the Raj Khalsa, Sarkar Khalsa, Ranjit Singh's government fought a war with the British. In English, they call these the Anglo-Sikh Wars. We were beaten in those wars, and that's a whole other story how we were beaten. And 2 years later, the Sikhs led the first rebellion against the British, which we call the Second Anglo-Sikh Wars. And unfortunately in that, we also lost. Great Sikhs like Baba Madhav Singh and Sardar Sham Singh Attari and other Sikhs were shaheed or imprisoned after those battles. And this here is a clock tower that the British built on the Parikrama of Harmandir Sahib. It's not there today, obviously. At this place, there used to be a haveli, a large mansion, that Maharaja Ranjit Singh had built on the Parikrama. As soon as the British took over Punjab, they understood the importance of Harmandir Sahib to the Sikh psyche, to our collective consciousness. And they turned Ranjit Singh's mansion on the Parikrama into a police station, where they put British police officers. After a few years, they turned it into a missionary center. The number of churches that had official missions in Punjab after the British took over was over 90 in the two decades after the British came. So they had a real goal, especially in those early years, to try and convert Sikhs away from Sikhi and Anglicize Punjab. Punjab was the last part of India they took over. It was considered the jewel of India, and they very much wanted to show that the British had full control there. And so eventually they destroyed and really they built this Gothic clock tower there to show that even here where you think you are sovereign or independent still, we have control of you even here. This was a situation in Punjab as politics was taken out of our control. For the first time in three generations, Sikhs were not free. We were Ghulam again to the British. And this created a situation where many un-Sikh-like practices began to occur within the community. Just as we see today in Punjab in the post-84 situation. So you can see this quote, that in Harmandir Sahib complex, there is actually a painting of Kali holding a khanda with Guru Gobind Singh Ji bowing in front of her with his shoes off. So this is on the Prakarma, there were these types of paintings. In fact, there were even murtis on the Prakarma of her mother's side. That was the situation of her mother's side. How bad is the situation of her mother's side? In the early 1900s, her mother's side, women were not allowed to enter her mother's side complex, which we have kept some of these unsick practices to this day. For example, not allowing women to do Seva Kirtan. That's an influence of this era. Low caste people were not allowed inside her mother's side either. They were not allowed past Darshini Jyoti. In addition, when Bhai Kansing Naba wrote his book, Hum Hindu Nahi Hain, we'll get to that in a while. He wrote a book saying, We Are Not Hindus. The head granthi of Harmandir Sahib wrote a book, and the title was, Hum Hindu Hain, We Are Hindus. That was the head granthi of Harmandir Sahib. Okay? All over Punjab, there were what we would call Deitari Gurus, people who were being worshipped as a Guru, calling themselves incarnations of the Guru, or to some other degree. This was a prevalent problem all over Punjab. We have an idea, a lot of people say, you know, the British weren't that bad. They brought education to Punjab. They brought railroads, canal system, highway, this and that. We forget how advanced the Sikh Raj was and how much damage was done to it. This is all British propaganda that we're still copying. In fact, under Sikh Raj, there was no capital punishment. Nobody was executed for any crimes. On the battlefield, Sikhs have always been fine with killing, because that's a battlefield. But outside the battlefield, Sikhs have always had a very strong principle of not executing prisoners. We were the only country in the world at that time. Countries in Europe only banned capital punishment, some as late as the 1970s, and then America still has it today, of course, right? Similarly, Ranjit Singh ensured that everybody in Punjab knew how to read basic Gurmukhi. And in fact, the local Pind Gurdwara was the center of this. Every child in every Pind knew how to read and write Punjabi. And do you know what they used as their teaching? Anybody know? Japji Sahib. So that those generations of Sikhs, regardless of whether they were uneducated, they didn't understand a lot of things, they had basic Bani knowledge and love and pyar within them from their childhood. And this includes women as well. So basic level of literacy and knowledge of Bani was compulsory all over the Sikh kingdom. The British destroyed this. They actually went through and burned all the Punjabi Keda, all the alphabet books to teach kids how to read and write Punjabi. This is according to British statistics. I know it's a very disturbing image, but this is according to British statistics, so we have to take them with a grain of salt, because they were manipulating their own statistics for their purposes, just like the Indian government does today. But according to their numbers, the number of Sikhs went from 10 million to 1 million. And that was within 13 years. What were those people becoming? They were becoming Christian and Hindu. So in large numbers, people were leaving Sikhi. So much so that it was assumed that within another generation or two, Sikhs would be wiped out. This is a quote by Gyani Dit Singh, and we'll get to who he is later. Just as we do not see any Buddhists in the country except in images, in the same fashion, Sikhs will only be seen in pictures in museums. Their own sons and grandsons, turning Christians and clad in coats and trousers and sporting toadstool caps, will go see them in museums and say in their pidgin Punjabi, "Look, that is a picture of a Sikh, the tribe that inhabited this country once upon a time." This is a Raja of Kapurthala. He is a direct descendant of Nawab Kapoor Singh. He was one of the few people that kept his independent state, but really under the purview of the British. And he was one of the first prominent people to convert to Christianity. He was promoted a lot by the British, you can imagine. So we were in need of a revolution. Throughout our history, we've had many different types of revolutions. We've had land reform, like Baba Banda Singh Bahadur, giving the Jameen back to regular people. We've had military revolution, like the Jathas and Missiles fighting against the Mughals. What type of revolution do they need now? It was a revolution of scholars. So I want to go through the different main people involved in the movement, and from their lives we can see what type of lives they led and what type of impact they had. This is Professor Gurmukh Singh. He came from a simple background. He was the first professor of Punjabi language ever. In the Ranjit Singh era, Punjabi was spoken by everybody, but the scholarly language, or the language of poets and the court, was not Punjabi. Punjabi was not considered a sophisticated language. In the court, the language was Persian. Just like in European courts up until the late Middle Ages, in England if you went, or France or Italy, they wouldn't be speaking Italian, French, or English, they'd be speaking Latin. Which is why a lot of mottos of different countries are still in Latin. Same way in Punjab, if you wanted to write poetry or books, does anyone know what language they used? Not the Persian. And anybody else?
Farsi or Persian?
No, not Farsi or Persian. Farsi was a political language, hadn't you?
Urdu?
British Bhasha, actually. British. That was the language that people wrote poetry in Punjab. So even our own historical records, like Bhai Ratan Singh Pangu's Prachin Panth Prakash, for example, or Kavi Santokh Singh's Suraj Prakash, those aren't written in Punjabi. Punjabi was not considered an educated language at that time. We had an insecurity built in with us about Punjabi. So Gurmukh Singh realized that to connect with the people, we need to start using their language. We need to start producing literature in their language. And so the first thing he did was created newspapers. Khalsa Gazette and Gurmukhi Akhbar. These were the first Punjabi language newspapers. Newspapers were a new invention. Printing presses had just been brought to India. They could publish lots of newspapers for very cheap, whereas in olden days, copying a book took a lot of work, whereas very few people understood Brij, and you would need a scholar to explain what was written in it, like a Nirmala or somebody else, to explain to you what was written. People themselves could read the newspaper and understand what was happening. And that was a way to get in touch with people. For his work, he also was prominent in getting Khalsa College built. And I start off with a picture of Khalsa College. Where Khalsa College was built was also very important to the Singh Sabha movement. Does anyone know what historical event happened on the field in front of Khalsa College? It's the very first battle in Sikh history. The Battle of Amritsar, where Guru Har Gobind Sahib Ji and the Sikh army beat the Mughal army. So right in front of Khalsa College, that's a battlefield there. That's where the battle occurred. Professor Gurmukh Singh, for his work, was kicked out of the panth by the Akal Takht at that time for promoting Sikhi, going against Devdari Gurus, and trying to teach Sikhi to women, low caste, and people converting from Islam. Those were the three things that they were most angry at. That you are giving Amrit to women, you are giving Amrit to low caste people, and you are giving Amrit to people who are converting from Islam. Because they believe that people who converted from Islam, the people should, Muslims should not be allowed to convert.
Why were people converting to Sikhi from Islam while apne se they were converting to Christianity?
So, that's an interesting point. The people were converting to Christianity in the pre-Singh Sabha movement. Once the Singh Sabha movement started in the 1870s, they started to hold these big, what they would call sabhas, right? And in those divans, people were getting attracted to Sikhi and started to convert. The message especially appealed to women and low-caste people. There were a few instances. There was one Muslim family who converted in the Amritsar area, and it was considered a very big deal. Muslims very rarely converted to Sikhi, even in the historical time period. Like, even during the Buddhist time, it was rare. Because if you're the dominant community, you won't convert. And there's always been a scene as Hindus converting isn't as big of a deal as Muslims. It's more of a cultural thing in India. Also, it's technically against the law for a Muslim to change their religion. Under a Muslim government, a strict Muslim government, you can be killed for that. Still today, in many Muslim countries, that's true. It's punishable by death to leave Islam. And Muslims were considered other people. So you could go and eat at a Hindu's house, but you couldn't eat at a Muslim's house. There was an otherness there within the Punjabi mentality. So a Muslim becoming a Sikh was a really big deal. And the traditional groups in Punjab were very against it. They tried to boycott Amritsar Jal. They tried to hold a protest in front of it. It was actually quite a huge event. The Amritsar Jal, where this man, his wife and his children took Amrit and became Sikhs. That family actually became quite prominent. The grandson became a famous Prajadak, actually. I can't remember his name. I'll find it for you afterwards. So the Kalpaka at that time, we have the same problem today. If you look at Sikh history, the amount of time that the Panth has had control of the Akaltakit compared to the amount of time that non-Panthic groups have had control is pretty dismal. We haven't had control of it for very short amounts of our history. How bad is the Akaltakit? I don't want to get too much into it, but has everyone here heard of Jallianwala Bagh?
Yeah.
Jallianwala Bagh was where General Dyer of the British shot to death, massacred at least 10,000 people, mainly Sikhs, on Vaisakhi in 1919 in Amritsar. And General Dyer, for having done that, was given a sroppa from Akal Takht. The only other people given a sroppa from Akal Takht in all the 20th century were Bhai Dhir Singh, Baba Kark Singh, and Bhagat Pooran Singh, and General Dyer. Okay. After he took Amrit from, after he got the sroppa, he went to Harmandir Sahib and they gave him Amrit. And he said, "I can't stop cutting my hair." And they said, "It's fine, you got Machan, that's good enough." And then he said, "I can't stop drinking." And they said, "How about just one drink a day?" And he said, "Sure, I can manage that." And then he said, "But I'd like to smoke." And they're like, "Okay, how about this? Every year you promise to smoke one less cigarette than the year before." So this is all true. And this happened within 100 years from today. So when you think that Bunt's in a bad situation, it's been worse, okay? But this is a type of situation people like Professor Gurmukh were working in. This is Gyani Dit Singh. He was what we call a Majbi Sikh, low caste, whom we today, still in Punjab, many people from, especially a Jat background, discriminate against in villages. Gyani Dit Singh, Professor Gurmukh Singh was the organizer. Gyani Dit Singh was the real genius behind the Singh Sabha movement. He wrote 70 books on Sikh history. Most of the Sakhis that we know today, many of them are famous from him. He's the one who wrote them down, spread them. He's the main person who wrote those newspapers that spread Sikhi. And he was a guy who would go and speak in a gurukul, do katha from the stage, and then they would make him sit in the shoes to get prashad, because he was low caste. And he didn't stop. We would say, "Oh man, they didn't give me enough respect, I'm not speaking there again." For him, his mentality was, as long as someone in the Sangat is getting some law from what I'm saying, I don't mind how they treat me. That was the mentality there. The mentality was, we don't care how they're treating us, we are talking about Guru's message, that's the important part. This is by Karam Singh Nabba. He was we would call him a genius by today's standards. He could quote like extensively from Guru Granth Sahib by the age of 10. His father was a Gyani, he came from that background. And he wrote the influential book, Hum Hindu Nahi. And his Mahakosh, which is an encyclopedia of Sikhi, is still the main text that people use to this day. So when you need to know something, you can't find the answer, whether it's about Barney or Sikh history, you still go to his book, which shows how influential. I mean, they're creating the stuff without access to electronic literature, literally spending decades on creating this work. So Max Arthur McAuliffe is an interesting person. I include him here for a couple of reasons. He was very friendly and close with the Singh Sabha movement. The British had hired a German writer, ethnographer we would call him, or anthropologist maybe today. His name was Trump. And Trump wrote the first English translation of Guru Granth Sahib, and it is horrible. He extensively disrespects Guru Sahib in his book. He says that it's I hate to say it, but I'm just quoting him. He says it's a worthless book. There's nothing, there's no gyan in it. It's not written. He had studied Sanskrit and he thought that Guru Granth Sahib was too simple. It wasn't complex enough for his liking. And he would, in fact, keep Guru Granth Sahib's sarup in his house on a table and put his feet up on the same table and so forth. So when the book was produced, the rich Sikhs who were British friends, what we would call collaborators, even they were disgusted by the book. So to keep their friends happy, the British hired this guy. And he turned out to be the opposite of Trump. He fell in love with Sikhi. And the way he writes about Sikhi is incredible. He wrote a 6-volume book, which is available in 3 parts, called The Sikh Religion. It's right there. And it's still a great book, a great resource. It's not perfect by any stretch, but what he did was that he went around all of Punjab and he essentially collected every single Sakhi he could find. And he put it in what he thought was chronological order. So there's going to be lots of strange Sakhis in there too, but it's also a very good resource to find. He also translated Bani very beautifully. And he wrote so positively about the Sikh faith that he was kicked out of his job by the British. He was sent back to England. His works were suppressed in Britain. They wouldn't publish him because he wrote about the Panth being sovereign, being free, all these political ideas, which the British couldn't stand. And when he died during Japji Sahib. So in my estimation, I can't think of what would make someone more of a Sikh than that. In fact, not only did he die during Japji Sahib, he demanded that his body be cremated according to Sikh ceremonies, not a Christian funeral. He was cremated with Girtan Soh Loving done. So that's Max Arthur McAuliffe. And I think lots of you have heard of Bhai Singh, a very famous Sikh scholar. 1,200 articles on Sikhi, 50 books. And a lot of people sometimes say, the Singh Sabha movement, too much, was too scholarly, too dry, too much writing about stuff, not enough Shardarbya. But if you read Bhai Veer Singh's books, you can tell immediately that this is a Naam Kamai Wala Singh. This is someone who has taken their Sikhi very seriously. Bhai Veer Singh wrote a Tika of Guru Granth Sahib Ji. He was unable to complete it in his life. It's only up to around 700 on, about halfway through. But it's still considered by many people to be the best Tika of Guru Granth Sahib Ji. Because whereas Professor Sahib Singh, who was also incredible, amazing Seva, went into more technical things, Bhai Veer Singh really went into the spiritual depth of each other. And reading it is like reading poetry, his explanation of the Bani. It's really incredible. So for those of you now, they've recently republished, those of you who can read Punjabi, his explanation of Japji Sahib and Sukhmani Sahib in smaller books, and they're really excellent resources. But anyways, Bhai Veer Singh, one thing he's really famous for, we've spoken about earlier, bringing Punjabi to the masses. He did that. He wrote the very first novel in Punjabi, which was Sundari. And not only did he write the first novel in Punjabi, he wrote the first long poem in Punjabi, what we would call an epic poem as well, which was Rana Surat Singh. Okay? He wrote all of these works, and he wrote it in accessible Punjabi so that everyday people could connect to it. And his focus in all of his works is Guru. How to connect with the Guru. He used Sikh history to inspire Sikhs, to lift them up. Because you can imagine the situation that Sikhs were in. Here you are, and you are living as slaves. Your grandmothers were free. And now you're living as slaves. And all around you, you see bad practices happening. It's so hard to find authentic Sikhi. And in that situation, Bhai Singh is writing books about these brave Sikhs in the 1700s, about brave Sikhs during the Guru's time, and he's writing beautiful poetry about Sikhi, about the Guru, sorry. And this is allowing people to fall in love with Sikhi again. So what tools did these Guru Sikhs use? The first thing was, they didn't want to just talk. So a lot of times, people like me, we end up going, we do a lecture, we say, this is what's wrong in the path, A, B, C, D, and then we go off, and everyone here feels down, and I feel good about myself, because I got to speak in front of a room full of people, and then nothing happens afterwards. Whereas they would have an annual conference, and they would hold it in a different village or city every year, and every time they did a conference, they would lay the foundation stone of a new school. So that everywhere they went, they said, we want to build a new school. So many of the Punjabi schools that are still in Punjab today, all of these Guru Hari Krishna Sahib Ji Elementary School or Mata Sahib Kaur School, all these schools were created by the Singh Sabha movement. A, that's amazing. B, that's a shame that in 150 years, have we as a community continued that? Here in BC, for example, it's been done, but in other places, have we continued that? Because the impact you can have on a child in their early years cannot be replicated again. And this has always been understood. The Christians understand this very well. And they put more money into education than anything. Muslims as well, you know, all of these very fundamentalist Muslim groups, they start off with building their schools attached to the mosques to indoctrinate children. Because they know that once a child is indoctrinated, it's very hard to turn them away. We're not talking about indoctrination. We're talking about trying to develop a relationship for children at a young age. And I want to now talk about two more people to go online. This is Bibi Hernampur. We have no pictures of her, unfortunately. But women were also a very prevalent part of the movement, of the Singh Sabha movement. Her and her husband, Bhai Takat Singh, built the first women's school. Well, this is a picture of the second, or the first boarding school is here in 1904. The first school was made in 1902. To build the school, she sold all her personal possessions, including the jewelry she had gotten for her wedding. So she sold everything she had to make a school. And not only was this school had accommodation so that any poor person or any woman who was a widow could come and live here for free. They could help in the education and they had a place to live. Does anybody know what the word for prostitute is in Punjabi? And what's the word for widow?
Widow.
Honey?
Vidva.
What's the root of the word Vishwa?
Kanjiri.
No, it comes from the same word, widow. It's the same root word. Because in Punjabi culture, a woman whose husband died had many times no other means to make a life for herself than to be forced into prostitution. That was the situation in Punjab. So Bibi Hernampur, seeing that situation, said, I'm going to create a place for women who have no means, can come, do seva, and also have a place to live. So this is the type of work they're doing. Community building, direct action, going out and helping people who need it the most. This is Bibi Agyakor. not a picture of her, sorry, this is a slide about her. Bibi Aage Kaur was another pioneer Sikh female education. She would go on kirtan tours all around India, and the money she raised would just be for the schools that she was setting up, which were girls' schools. So setting up schools and colleges for women was one of the big focuses. So even though as a community we many times have a lot of sexism and discrimination, we also inherently within us have certain principles that we've kept that we just need to get back in touch with. So that, we spoke earlier in my discussion, we were talking about Bibi Babir Kaur, who was Shaheed in the Jaito Morcha. And when she wanted to walk at the head of the Morcha, the men said, you know, you need to go to the back where the other women are. And she challenged them and she said, you know, I also took Amrit from Guru Gobind Singh just like you. And they had nothing to say then. So that even though there is sexism, when challenged, a Gursikh male who's in touch with Sikhi will understand that what he's saying is wrong, if they are coming from a Sikh perspective. Similarly, and we'll talk about the SGPC later, about how it hasn't worked out very well for us, but the SGPC, when it was made in 1920, gave women the right to vote, equally to men. And that was before women had the right to vote in Canada. That was before women had the American women had just gotten the right to vote a few years earlier. In Switzerland, women only got the right to vote in 1972, the last European country. So Sikhs have been on the forefront. We just many times allow Punjabi culture to override real Pantik, what we could say, what we call Pantik culture. So this is one thing I want to talk to about with everyone here, a lot of young people, that we have tools of media that young Sikhs 100 years ago would have really been very jealous of. We have the ability to post something and have it be read by the whole world right away. We have the ability to produce a video that could be seen by anybody right away. So, just as Sikhs in the early 1900s and late 1800s took a British tool, which was a printing press, which was brought to India to print Bibles, print British propaganda, print Christian missionary work, took those tools and instead started printing newspapers, Punjabi textbooks, and most importantly, Guru Granth Sahib Ji's and Gurdke, they took the technology around them and utilized them for a much greater purpose. So the point is not to reject the technology that you have around us. Sikhs have never rejected the society we have around us. We've used a society to spread our own unique message. Guru Har Gobind Sahib Ji saw that in the pens around Punjab, what was the popular way of inspiring people? What were the stories that people told? They listened to Dadi Rara. The Dadi Rara were famous rajas, famous warriors, those types of things. But Guru Har Gobind Sahib Ji didn't go and tell the Sikhs, stop singing these Dadi Rara. Instead, he created a tradition where instead of singing about these mythological or historical figures, they started to sing about Sikh warriors and Shaheeds. Similarly, Guru Nanak Sahib Ji saw that people used music for all sorts of different purposes, entertainment, religious. Guru Nanak Sahib didn't say, stop using music. He instead took music and made it pavitra by using it for Gurbani Kirtan. So we have a tradition of taking the media or the means around us and turning it into something we can use. We have to ask ourselves today, how can we use the resources we have today to spread? So it's both a negative and a positive. The printing press was a positive in that you could spread things a lot easily. It was a negative in that anybody could write anything they wanted and spread it. And so you had a lot of nonsense being published too. It's a positive that Guru Granth Sahib Ji could now be printed on printing presses so that there weren't just a few handwritten sloops in a few places. But it's a negative in that people very quickly started to not respect Guru Granth Sahib Ji enough and kept Guru Granth Sahib Ji in their homes in disrespectful ways. which happened in a few years. So there's always a positive and negative, similarly today. I'm not going to talk about the bad parts about YouTube or social media. I'm talking about even the fact that people can spread all sorts of ridiculous stuff. The point is, never in Sikh history have Sikhs worried about what other people are spreading. When Baba Bhai Makhan Shah found Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahibji, and Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahibji was recognized as the Guru. Can everybody stand up for a second? Everyone's falling asleep. Rahi Guru. Spread all the way up. Pretty good. I'm going to pretend it's not my talking, it's lunch. When Bhai Makhan Shah found Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahibji, he found Guru Tegh Bahadurji. In Baba Bakala at that time, how many fake gurus were there? Does anyone remember? 22. There were 22 fake gurus. After Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahibji was recognized and the whole Sangat came, and there was a huge divan, all the Sikhs were there, what did they do to those 22 Deitari gurus? Anybody know? Huh? I know what we would have done. We were going to beat them up, right? Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahibji said, just ignore them. In fact, Dirmal, the main one of their, the main of the 22 Deitari gurus, who was Guru Hardai Sahib's older brother, Dirmal, came with a gun and shot Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahibji in the shoulder. By Makhan Shah and some other Sikhs, you know, some young Sikhs like these guys over there with the malleh, went and beat the crap out of Dirmal. And they also took back the Kartarpur Sarup, the Kartarpuri Veer of Guru Granth Sahib, the original one that Dirmal had stolen from Guru Har Gobind Sahib Ji. And Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib Ji not only made them return the Kartarpur Veer to Dirmal, he also made them go and ask forgiveness from Dirmal for beating him up. So, Guru Tegh Bahadur Ji wasn't worried at all about these people. He didn't go, shut them up, they're saying anti-Sikh stuff, or they're disrespecting me. He had full confidence in his ability and his power as a guru. And he had full confidence in his panth that they didn't have to worry about these people. They, by themselves, just all disappeared. Similarly, if we are confident in our message, and more importantly, our message has that kernel of nam and truth within it, then it doesn't matter what all these other people are saying. People who have that ability to recognize the truth, like Bhai Makhan Shah, will find it. So, while there is a problem, definitely in today's media or today's world, of a huge mass of information, that shouldn't be a detriment for us to spread our message. So, I want to talk quickly about the impact of the Singh Sabha movement. The Singh Sabha movement was, first of all, a huge influence on the generation of scholars that came afterwards. People like Professor Sahib Singh, Siddhartha Kapoor Singh, Professor Tejas Singh, and Professor Purna Singh. These were all great Sikhs whose works we still read today. The generation of Sikhs who grew up studying under the Singh Sabha movement became, when they grew up, the Sikhs that freed the Gurdwara. And their children were the ones who then freed India. So right now, we are trying to, like in English as an expression, put the cart before the horse. We want to go to Punjab and get rid of the Indian Sarkar. But we haven't even created a generation of children that can free our own Gurdwara first. So, the Singh Sabha movement, Bhai Veer Singh didn't go out there and start trying to fight the British with a gun. He instead saw that what the Panth needed then was a way to connect with Bani, connect with Sikh history. So they created Tikas, Steaks. They created newspapers, articles, books. That could spread the message of Sikhi in a way that people understood for the first time. And that, in time, flowered into this huge force that, though we were less than 2% of India's population, were able to eject the British from all of South Asia. We were the main group who pulled that off. But today, there has become, especially in the last recent years, increasing criticism of the Singh Sabha movement and a return to the type of propaganda that existed before the Singh Sabha movement was created. So this is RSS type propaganda. You may have seen stuff like this. Here, the gurus are in the cow, representing Mother Hinduism, and Amrit is the cow's milk. This is a crew. This is what they were doing like 20 years ago. They're much smarter than this now today. You can go online and you can see them giving speeches, and they say stuff like, they use quotes from Bani where Ram, for example, is used for Vaheguru. And they'll say, oh, well, Guru Nanak is saying you should worship Ram, for example. So that still is very basic, and any Sikh with a simple understanding of Bani will be able to counter them. But the point is that there are forces who have a huge amount of wealth who are directly trying to undermine our community. We need to always be ready to teach what we could call authentic Sikhi. So, I want to give a small critique of the Singh Sabha movement too. In everything, there needs to be balance. When the Singh Sabha movement came, we had swung too much to one side as a community. People were worshipping gurus, worshipping idols. They were following all types of Hindu practices. People had turned away from basic maryada. Tobacco farming had become prevalent in parts of Punjab. Alcohol use was very high. People were doing many types of anti-Sikh practices. The Singh Sabha movement came, and in some ways we swung too much to one side. What side was that? Trying to understand Guruji exclusively through books, studying all the time, trying to get rid of all spiritual or things that were not understandable and putting them in a very Western scientific model, which also isn't, I feel, really in line with Sikhi. We can understand it because it swung too much to one, because of how extreme the situation was when they came. But this has led to, directly, unfortunately, to things like people questioning certain fundamental sakis from Sikh history, people questioning the Dasabani, for example. This is a Dasabani Sadhup here. And things that are that type of very positive, inquisitive mind that people like Ganidit Singh had, saying, Sikhs, use your mind, understand this is not Sikh practice. We are now starting to turn that on everything and criticize everything. And A, that's not in the spirit of those six, because all of them were people who were very connected to Nam and Bani, and who took that very seriously. And B, their purpose in critiquing was to try to return us to the Guru, not to start criticizing Guru Sahib itself, which is what we are now doing, right? And so in everything, there needs to be a balance. And I think as a community, we need to find a balance in between the two. But what's happened now is, and this is McLeod. He passed away recently. He's a New Zealand scholar. And most of the Sikh professors, and by Sikh professors, I mean professors of Sikhi, not of necessarily they're Sikh, in universities across North America and Britain, are either indirect or directly students of his. And they have criticize basic parts of Sikhi. And this is the type of Sikhi that's now being taught in schools and universities. What type of things do they say? They say things like Guru Arjan Sahib Ji, changed Guru Granth Sahib Ji to suit the message at the time. He changed Urdu Guru's Bani and edited it. Guru Har Gobind Sahib Ji only told Sikhs to start using weapons because too many Jats converted to Sikhi during his time, and Jats were people that fought, and so to keep them happy, he told them to start fighting. So that's problematic for a lot of reasons. One of the very basic reasons that Jats didn't convert to Sikhi until Baba Singh Bahadur's time in large numbers, not during Guru Har Gobind's time. But anyways, really ridiculous stuff like that. Some Kachi Bani that appears in some old Guru Granth Sahib Ji sloops, they are also saying that that is Bani as well. One of them is an obvious Kachi Bani that Sikhs have long recognized, and it says that it's a Shabad attributed to Guru Arjan Sahib Ji, where he says that he cut Guru Har Gobind's hair for the Munya ceremony that Hindus do. So we can see, not only from the context, but even how it's written, it's wrong. But Macabre has literally written entire articles and devoted chapters of his books to that one Shabad, just to prove the point that Sikhs used to cut their hair. This is the kind of stuff that's being done. These people have a lot of funding. Their books get published from Oxford University Press India, and they look really nice, and they show up in bookstores all around the world. And we need to be careful of it. When I said earlier we should be worrying, we should be worrying if we also are producing quality products of our own. The issue now is that we're not producing anything, the only thing we produce is this, in a lot of instances. That's the one problem. They believe, and the big argument, and this is Harjot Oberoi, who teaches at UBC, he wrote this book, Construction of Religious Boundaries. His big thesis, idea is that the Singh Sabha movement created Sikhi. There were no Sikhs before the Singh Sabha movement. There were only Hindu Sikhs. Sikhs were a type of Hindu. Singh Sabha movement came, and the British, under British control, they created Sikhs to divide and conquer the Punjab population. So you can say, well, this doesn't make sense for so many reasons, right? And I'm not going to go into all the different reasons why it doesn't make sense. But this has been taught seriously in universities as truth. And this is what people think is the truth now. The Singh Sabha movement was a British creative movement used to manipulate Punjabis into calling themselves Sikhs. And what we have to recognize is this. The Singh Sabha movement did do one thing. They used British models. They used British education system, British colleges, British-style textbooks. They wrote about Sikhi in British styles, so sometimes if you read their books in English, there'll be a lot of comparisons to the Bible or Jesus. Just as when Sikhs are writing in the 1800s, they compare stuff to the Vedas or the Puranas and to Hindu gods, because they're writing in the context of that culture. Secondly, they're using the tools that are available to them. Those are the tools they have. This Singh Sabha, anti-Singh Sabha movement has now appeared most dramatically in what I call the Neo-Nihangs, who are based out of Britain. And the Neo-Nihangs are a group that claim to be Nihang Singhs, but in their websites or their works, for example, openly call the Gurus Hindus, and openly call Sikhs as Hindus, and are very anti-Singh Sabha movement. They produce beautiful books that many of you might have in your house, like this, which is a beautiful book with amazing pictures until you read the text, where it is spreading one message, and that is that Sikhs used to be Hindus, there used to be diversity in the community, meaning diversity meaning we used to be Hindus, and now we are too rigid and too Singh Sabha. If you follow the funding, where did the money come to produce this book? It comes directly from the British government in Britain through grants, and the Indian Embassy in Britain through cultural grants. These are where these books are being produced from. And this is not conspiracy theory, this is basic stuff. That's who's producing their work. So we have to look at why is it being produced. Can you imagine publishing a book on Harmandir Sahib? And even if it's a historical book, can you imagine not once mentioning 1984? not once mentioning Akal Takht being destroyed, and this book has not one mention of 1984 in it. So, this is the situation we're in today. When people are critical of the Singh Sabha movement, we should be take them at face value first and say, well, what are your criticisms? And ask them, do you want a Harmandir Sahib where women were not allowed? Do you want a Harmandir Sahib where there's idols? Do you want a Nankana Sahib where little girls are being raped, which is what happened before the Sikhs went to free Nankana Sahib? Do you want a Akal Takht that gives sarupas to people who kill Sikhs? Because that was a situation in Punjab before the Singh Sabha movement came. So as much as we may criticize the Singh Sabha movement for some things, being too rigid, too scholarly, not having enough sharda, for example, we might say, the situation they were in, what they were able to achieve, and the impact they had on the Panth and on all of India and the world was very huge and should be commended. And the way they did it. So many times today, and Uncle Lee asked me, but I won't call him because he's sleeping. No, but Uncle Lee asked me, what type of revolution should we have today? So we all ask, what type of revolution should we have today? And when you're younger, like I was, and I had all my photos of Shaheeds up in my apartment, I used to dream of going to Punjab with an AK-47, you know, all of that. But that would be the revolution that we had. And I was skinnier then, so it could have worked. But we have to ask ourselves, 5 years ago, anybody know how old he was when he wrote Sundari? He was 18 years old when he wrote the first novel in Punjabi language ever. So, we have to ask ourselves as a community, all of us, where is our work? Where is our literature? When we read Guru Granth Sahib Ji, we are using Bhaivir Singh or Professor Sahib Singh. Or some people might use Preet Kaur Tika. All of those are over 70 years old at least. Professor Sahib Singh is from the 1960s. Bhaivir Singh is from the 40s and 50s. Preet Kaur Tika is from the 1890s. So we are using resources that are decades old. Not that they're wrong, but the message that they had in them was for the people of their group. The Sakhis that Bhaivir Singh and Gyani did Singh spread, those were Sakhis that made sense for them in that situation to inspire those Sikhs. What Sakhis do we need to teach our children in Canada or Britain or Australia that will inspire them in this culture? Which verse 6 do we need to talk about? Which stories do we need to spread? How do we understand Bani? A lot of people are like, you know, Bani, the translations, and I don't doubt it, the English translations that we have of Bani are pretty abysmal. And we should all agree that the translations are not the way we should be connecting to Bani. We should be making an effort to understand Bani directly. But still, translations help. They bring people to Sikhi. They create an interest. They keep children involved in the Gurdwara, for example. And they allow a lot of people, I know a lot of people who were just by reading translations at Kirtan or Rinspay or somewhere Samagam have been inspired to start learning more about Sikhi. Now imagine if those were written by someone of your generation. Someone who had spent the time studying Sikhi, fall in love with the Guru, and produce something of, you know, some worth. It's not impossible. Where is our creativity as a community? You know, these guys wrote novels, poetry, and this is beautiful stuff that you can still read today. You know, those of you who have never read Professor Puran Singh, it's beautiful work. But then when you're reading it, it's also very sexist sometimes, because he's writing in the 1920s, from a British education. And so sometimes it just doesn't feel right because he's a totally different culture. But we're still stuck reading that because we haven't produced anything ourselves, right? On the sexism front though, very interesting thing, almost all of Bhaivir Singh's novels and large poems have a female protagonist. So it's something to think about, that Bhai Veer Singh understood that the message of Sikhi is best explained through the relationship of a woman coming and learning about Sikhi. And that was what inspired people the most. I mean, Sundari is about a young girl who's stolen by the Mughals to go on slave markets, and Sikhs free her. She goes back to her village, and her family rejects her because she's impure, because she's been around Muslims now. And she joins the Khalsa and becomes a part of Bhai Garur Singh's missile. So that's the type of literature they were creating that was inspiring people. We have to ask ourselves, how can we do that? And the main way you do that, and this is a part that we also said earlier, and Bhaisab said earlier today, is to start developing a relationship with Guru Granth Sahib Ji. By developing a relationship with Guru Granth Sahib Ji, that's where the inspiration comes from. So, for example, there's a lot of activist groups out there now. I used to be part of a lot of activist groups when I was younger. And most activism, when it comes from a place of anger. You're mad about the situation, you want to go out and change it. That type of activism can never be sustained. The type of activism that inspired Gyani Dit Singh, who is being disrespected so much everywhere he goes because he's about to be sick, or Professor Gurmukh Singh, who's kicked out of the Panth for his prachar, that's not from anger, that's from pyar. That is his connection to Guru Granth Sahib Ji. That's what's inspiring him. So once we connect to Guruji, that is the type of inspiration that doesn't die off. The people say, oh, I feel burnt out. I feel tired. I can't keep this up anymore. No. Think about Baba Janel Singh in 1983, where he is addressing, I don't know how many tens of thousands of people, for like 2 hours a day, twice a day, and then in the middle, speaking to people and organizing stuff all day. He's got a serious health condition as well. He had some type of anemia of some kind. And he is able to stand there on stage hour after hour, inspiring people to come to the Khalsa Panth and stand with the Panth against the Indian government. Now, if that was coming from anger, if that was coming from just being pissed off at how the Indian government is treating us, it would not have been sustainable. It was coming from his profound and deep love of Guru Granth Sahib Ji. That's what was inspiring him. So, you know, it's not that relevant here. You know, we're here at Khalsa Center, here is an institution. We used to dream when we were younger, running camps, how great it would be if we didn't have to rent camps, and there was actually a campsite that had a gurdwara and had a langar hall, and we didn't have to worry about all those issues. So it's pretty awesome. So something that we need to continue to do. We are builders as a people. Guru Nanak Sahib Ji, you know, he didn't tell Sikhs, come back to Punjab with me and we'll set something up at Kartarpur Sahib. He said, you stay here, you start at Dharamsal, and you teach Sikhi here where you are. Everywhere he went, he did that. So that's the Sikh tradition. That where you are, you build there and you teach Sikhi there. And I've already gone over this a little bit, but this is an early printed Surupa Guru Granth Sahib Ji. It's pretty amazing to see. And we can see here, that was one of the first things that Sikhs did, just like one of the first things that I know a lot of Sikhs did when the internet became prevalent was putting Guru Granth Sahib Ji online as well, which is a cool parallel. I want to end with this from 5 years thing from Sundari, this first novel. Look at yourselves and see whether or not the decline of the Sikh nation is caused by your very own hands. Meaning, we always say, oh, it's because people are attacking us. People are speaking against us. That's why we're in a bad situation. He said, look at yourselves. Leaving your God and your true gurus, you worship stones, trees, idols, tombs, and saints. Forgetting Sikhi, you rot in another religion. Turning your back on the Guru, you teach someone else's religion to your offspring too. Your children will grow up to be half-baked like you. Sikh on the head, Brahmin around the neck, and Muslim below the waist. Okay? So, it's a question to us, those of us who are young parents, and those of you who are going to be parents soon. It'll happen before you know it, trust me. Your parents are probably already hassling you to get married. Those of you who are like over 18, I think it starts right then, right? So, how will you raise your children? Sikhi starts in the home, then it starts in your community, and then it becomes Panthik. We want to do everything backwards. We want to saw fix the Panth, and we don't want to fix our own families first. So first you deal with your own family, then once you have your family, you can start working on your community, and then the Panthik deals with itself as different Sikh communities come together. So stop worrying about the whole Panth, start worrying about ourselves. Connect to the Guru and start creating literature. Start creating things that will appeal to people. You know, I don't know if a novel about Sikhi would do that well today, but I know that an animation that's funny or interesting would do really well. I know that a video game, even if it's pretty crude, some type of flash video game about Baba Deep Singh killing mortals would be hilarious and probably do really well. And it'd be an interesting way just to get people interested in Sikhi, and that's how you start. And then from there you can produce more things of more depth, things of more value. Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, Vaheguru Ji Ki Fateh.